Hello everyone, so welcome to Dr. Ankit Pharmacology series. So today we will be discussing about an updated lecture of general anesthetics. So let's see, what do we mean by the word general anesthetic? Here the word general means, we will write loss of consciousness. Okay, general means loss of consciousness, because these drugs will be acting in central nervous system and they will suppress central nervous system, there will be loss of consciousness. And the second term is anesthesia. Now, anesthesia means that there is reversible loss of sensation. Reversible loss of sensation to noxious or painful stimulus. Okay? To noxious stimulus. So, if we will give a surgical incision or any painful stimulus, the person will not respond. So this is the complete definition. Now if you will compare this general anesthetic term with local anesthesia. Local anesthesia, remember anesthesia means reversible loss of sensation. Local means that these drugs, they will be acting in peripheral nervous system. Peripheral nervous system. Okay, as it will be acting on peripheral nervous system, not in brain. Remember, there is no loss of consciousness. There is no loss of consciousness. So local anesthetic will not produce make a patient unconscious. General anesthetic will produce. Now let's see what are the different stages of anesthesia we know. So when we will give general anesthetic, how does a person become unconscious? So let's make a heading, stages of anesthesia. Now stages of anesthesia was first described by a scientist known as Goodell. There was a scientist named Goodell. This Goodell used a general anesthetic known as ether. Okay? He used a general anesthetic ether. And that is why it is known as Goodell stages of ether anesthesia. Goodell stages of ether anesthesia. Now, why he used this ether? Because this ether was a very slow acting drug. It was a very slow acting general anesthetic, so that we can easily see the all stages of general anesthesia. But remember, nowadays we use the newer general anesthetic drugs or modern general anesthesia. With this modern general anesthetic agent, remember, these stages of Goodell's are not seen. These Goodell stages are not seen with nowadays the general anesthetic which we use. So it was a historical term either. So let's talk about stages of anesthesia which were described by Goodell with the general anesthetic known as ether. So Goodell's stages were divided into four. So there are how many stages are there? You will write there are four stages of general anesthesia. There are how many stages? Four stages. So let's see, when we will give ether, how does a person become unconscious? So first is stage one. In stage 1, when we give general anesthetic ether, there is just loss of pain sensation. The first stage is known as analgesia. Analgesia means there will be no pain. So stage 1 is known as analgesia. But remember, the patient is conscious. The patient is conscious at this stage. The patient, there is no loss of consciousness. Okay? So remember, but the patient, he or she is conscious. And remember, there is normal autonomic reflexes. The protective reflex of our body are still preserved. Okay, there is no loss of protective reflexes like gag reflex. There is no effect on heart. There is no cardio, respiratory, depression, because all these things are controlled by autonomic nervous system. Autonomic nervous system is well preserved. Okay, there is just loss of pain sensation. Okay, now is there any use of stage 1? Yes, stage 1 is used when we want just the patient not to feel pain. So this stage 1 is used during labor. During labor means during child delivery. So what is the use of stage 1 pain, stage of analgesia? It is used during labor. Okay, now after we will increase the dose, if we will increase the dose of either anesthesia, the person will go into stage 2. So now the patient will go into stage 2. Okay. Now stage 2, we will write, is the stage of delirium. Delirium means एक्यूट कंफ्यूजनल स्टेट और एक्साइटमेंट. द पर्सन विल बिकम एक्साइटेबल. Now, why the person will become excitable? Because this general anesthetic will reduce inhibitory nerve impulse in CNS. Okay? So, it will start depressing CNS, but the first nerves which will be inhibited are inhibitory nerves. That is why there is excitement in CNS. Okay? So, in this stage, how does the patient will appear? We will write. In this stage, the patient will struggle. The patient will resist to the procedures you are doing. The person will struggle or resist to the procedures, any surgical procedure. There will be breath holding. There will be cough. There will be sneezing. So you cannot put an endotracheal tube at this time. Okay. Remember, there will be increase in muscle tone. This is how you can easily identify stage 2. So, there will be rigidity in the body. Okay. So, there will be laryngospasm. The larynx will undergo into spasm, which could be dangerous, and you cannot put an endotracheal tube to provide anesthesia. The jaw will become rigid. So, you cannot open the mouth. Okay. Now, the second point is, what about respiration? The respiration will be irregular respiration. Respiration will be irregular. So you are seeing everything has become very disturbed in stage 2, and there will be increase in heart rate. Okay. Now, any utility of stage 2? Remember, stage 2 has no utility. We don't want stage 2 in our patient. It is undesirable state. There is no use of stage 2. Okay. Undesirable. Now you will further increase the dose of general anesthetic. The person will go into stage 3. Now, stage 3 is known as stage of surgical anesthesia. Stage 3 is known as stage of surgical anesthesia. This is the best stage which we require in our patient. Okay. Stage 3. Okay. Now, if you talk about stage 3, remember stage 3, it is divided into 4 planes. It is further divided into 4 planes. Okay. So, it is further divided into 4 planes or 4 zones. First is plane 1. Then we will write plane 2. So, the direction is from plane 1, plane 2, plane 3 and plane 4. Okay. Now, in plane 1, remember there is loss of reflex. Now, which loss of reflex, autonomic reflex will be lost? We will write that there is loss of conjunctival reflex. Okay. There is loss of conjunctival reflex. There is loss of cutaneous reflex on skin. Okay. Now, remember, if you will see the eye of the person, the pupil will be constricted. So, there will be constricted pupil. In stage 1. Okay. So, there will be constricted pupil in stage 1. Now, let's talk about stage 2. In stage 2, there is loss of corneal reflex. There is loss of corneal reflex, laryngeal reflex. So, you can put an endotracheal tube. Okay. There is loss of peritoneal reflex. So, you can put an abdominal incision. Okay. And here, remember, the pupil will start dilating. The pupil will start dilating in stage 2. This is how you can identify. Now, if you talk about plane 3. In plane 3, that there is loss of light reflex. That when you will put an light stimulus to the eye, there will be no constriction of pupil. And remember, here the pupil will be maximum dilated pupil. Maximum dilated pupil. Okay. And in plane 4, we will write in plane 4 that there is loss of all above reflex. There is no more reflex which is left. Okay. So, after plane 3, that there is loss of all reflex. Remember, the pupil is already dilated. Plus, remember, the muscle will become totally relaxed. The muscle tone will decrease to the maximum in stage 4. So, the person will not move. So, these are the four planes of stage 3. Okay, stage 3. Now, remember one very important point you have to remember, that with modern IV general anesthetic agent, nowadays which we are using, remember there is no stage 1 and stage 2. Remember, the patient directly comes into stage 3. The patient directly enters into stage 3 with modern day rapidly acting general anesthetic agent. Okay, so the patient will directly enter into stage 3. Okay, now as we know that there is loss of cutaneous reflex. That there is loss of cutaneous reflex. In which stage? Can you tell me in which stage there is loss of cutaneous reflex? Can we say plane 1? So in plane 1, we know that there is loss of cutaneous reflex. Can we say that if there is no cutaneous reflex, we can make a skin incision? So skin incision can be made in which phase? Plane 1. Because in plane 1, if you will make a skin incision, the person will not withdraw his or her body part. Now, can you tell me in which stage there is loss of peritoneal reflex? Can you tell me in which stage there is loss of peritoneal reflex? See and tell me. Cutaneous, I think peritoneal we have written in plane 2. Plane 2 we have written. So, can we say that in peritoneal reflex is lost in plane 2? Hence, can we say that we can make abdominal incision? Because peritoneum is a part of, okay, that there is loss of peritoneal reflex in plane 2. So, that is why we can make abdominal incision in plane 2. And remember, after plane 3, there is loss of all reflex. Loss of all reflex. And you can easily do any type of surgery. This is the best stage of surgery for a patient. You can do a surgery in a patient in plane 3. Okay? Plane 3. Now, if you will further increase the dose of general anesthetic agent either, the patient will come into stage 4, which is the last stage of general anesthetic. Now, stage 4 is known as stage of medullary paralysis. Stage of medullary paralysis. Now, you know that the brain and the brain stem, which is the part of medulla, from medulla, remember, it controls our heart, it controls our respiration or lungs. So, if these medullary neurons become paralyzed, there is cardiac and respiratory failure. Or cardiac and respiratory arrest or failure, the person will not breathe, the person heart will not beat, and the person will become dead. So remember, we never give stage 4. Never reach stage 4. Because the person will become dead. Okay, in stage 4. So these are the four stages of Guiddel, stages of general anesthesia, which was described by Guiddel. And it was described on either. But nowadays, modern anesthetics, they don't show this clear-cut demarcation. Now, let's talk about the modern anesthesia. Let's talk about by the term nowadays what we are doing. In our modern day practice, we use a term known as balanced anesthesia. We use a term known as balanced anesthesia. Okay? So, we use a term balanced anesthesia nowadays. Now, what do we mean by the word balanced anesthesia? Remember, in balanced anesthesia, it has four components. That when you are operating a patient and you are giving a general anesthetic agent, okay, general anesthetic, five things. When you are giving a general anesthetic agent, the patient should have loss of all pain sensation. So there should be analgesia, loss of pain. The patient should not feel pain. Remember, there should be muscle relaxation. There should be muscle relaxation so that the person should not move during our surgical procedure. There is amnesia or loss of memory. person should not remember anything. There should be loss of consciousness. The person should not be awake. And lastly, there should be abolition of reflex response to noxious stimulus or painful stimulus. So these are the five parameters of balanced anesthesia. Okay, so we will write a mnemonic for this, AMLA. Okay, so A for, repeat again, there should be loss of pain, analgesia. M for, there should be muscle relaxation. Next, A for, loss of memory, amnesia. L for, loss of consciousness. Okay, and last A for, abolition of reflex. So that when we give a painful stimulus, the patient should not move. So these are the four stages of balanced anesthesia, and these four things must be produced in a patient when we are giving a general anesthetic agent in our patient. So these are the five things which we require in our general anesthetic, but unfortunately no single general anesthetic agent, no single general anesthetic agent can produce all desired effects. No one drug can produce all desired effect. Because of this reason, hence we have to use combination of drugs. Hence we have to use combination of drugs to provide, to make anesthesia a balanced anesthesia. Hence we have to give a combination of drug, because no one drug can produce all of the following effect. Hence we have to give combination of drug. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about the drugs we have in general anesthetics. So drugs in general anesthetic agents. Okay, now general anesthetic agents, they are divided into two according to their route. What is their route of administration? Either they are divided into inhalational agent. Okay, inhalational agents, they are given by gases, or they are intravenous agents. Intravenous agents. Now, let's talk about first, let's write the list of the names of the all drugs. So first, about inhalational general anesthetics, they are divided into two. Either they are given as a gases, or they are given as a volatile liquid. Remember, volatile liquid, they evaporate, and when they evaporate, they turn into gases. Okay, so volatile liquid, they evaporate and they turn into gases. So they are given inhalationally. So let's talk about which gases we generally use as a general anesthetic. The first one we will write is nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide. Second, we will write Entonox. Third, we will write Xenon. And a new gas we will write helium. Helium. So these are the gases we have among inhalational agent. Among volatile liquid, we will write a mnemonic, catch, my side. Catch my side. So the drugs we will write are C for chloroform, E for ether, T for trialine, C for cyclopropane, H for a very important drug, halothane, M for methoxyfluorine, S for sevoflurane, I for isoflurane, D for desflurane, and lastly n-fluorine. Okay, so last five drugs you are seeing are ending with the word fluorines. Okay, so they contain fluoride, that is why fluorine. Okay, so this is the mnemonic you must remember. Catch my side. Among intravenous anesthetic agents, they are also further divided into two. One you will write as an intravenous inducing agent. They are given only initially to make a patient unconscious. Then we maintain by gases, IV inducing agents, but there will be certain exception, and certain adjunctive drugs. Adjunctive or add-on drugs. So add-on drugs, they are given to all of these drugs. All of these drugs we give add-on drugs. Okay. So IV inducing agent, you will write a mnemonic. Temp. Temp means temperature. Which temperature you will write? Kelvin temperature. So the drugs are, the first drug you will write is thiopentone. E for etomidate. M for methohexitone, P for a very important drug propofol, and K for ketamine. So these are the IV inducing agents that you must remember. Okay, IV inducing agent. As an add-on drug, we have various drugs like dexmedetomidine. Dexmedetomidine, I will be telling you, it is used for producing sedation only. For pain relief, we give opioids. Then we will write benzodiazepine to produce amnesia and sedation. So adjunctive drug. Okay. Then we will write droperidol, an antipsychotic drug. Anti-emetics to prevent nausea and vomiting, anticholinergic or antimuscarinic to prevent reflux or aspiration, that we will discuss their role. So this is the complete list of general anesthetic agents that you must remember. Okay, general anesthetic agents. So let's see first, what is their mechanism of action? Let's see first, what is the mechanism of action of general anesthetic agents? Okay. Mechanism of action. Okay. Now, the mechanism of action of general anesthetic agents is that they suppress CNS. They suppress central nervous system. Remember, they suppress almost all areas of CNS. They suppress almost all areas of CNS. Like, remember, if the thalamic neurons, they get suppressed, there will be loss of consciousness. The person will undergo sleep. Similarly, if hippocampal neurons are blocked, there will be amnesia, memory loss. Similarly, if cortical motor neurons are blocked, there will be muscle relaxation, etc. Okay? So, all areas. Now, the second question arises, sir, how do they suppress the neurons of CNS? There was an earlier hypothesis that this hypothesis states that all general anesthetic agent, how do they suppress CNS? This hypothesis was known as unitary hypothesis. It is also known as Mayer Overton rule. Mayer Overton rule. Now this hypothesis stated that suppose this is a neuron in CNS. All general anesthetic agent, remember, they interfere with the lipid cell membrane. Of neurons. And because of interference or perturbation, interference with lipid cell membrane, what happens? The ion movements inside the cell, sodium chloride ion movement inside the cell and outside the cell is interfered. So ion movement inside or outside the these neuronic channels, they are interfered or they are disturbed, perturbation. Because of this reason, these neurons get suppressed. Okay, but now you have to remember that this hypothesis now is totally rejected. This hypothesis now is totally rejected. We don't follow unitary hypothesis or Mayer-Overton rule. So now we know that the exact mechanism of action of general anesthetic is on a neuronal cell membrane. Remember, they don't interact with lipid. They don't interact with lipid, rather they interact with proteins on the cell membrane. So by and acting on these proteins on the cell membrane, what they will be doing, we will write, by acting on the proteins on the cell membrane, what they will be doing, they will be increasing inhibitory impulse. They will be increasing inhibitory impulse in a neuron, and they will be decreasing excitatory impulse in a neuron. So overall effect will be CNS suppression. So remember, general anesthetic agent, they increase inhibitory impulse and they reduce excitatory impulse. Hence, they will produce CNS suppression by acting on proteins. Now, let's see what are these proteins which we are talking about. The first, you know that that in our brain, there is an inhibitory neurotransmitter known as GABA. And this GABA, remember, acts on a channel known as GABA-A chloride channel. So it's a protein which is present on cell membrane. So remember, they are GABA-A chloride channel agonist. They will open this GABA-A chloride channel. Okay. So if because of this reason, remember, the chloride ion will move inside. Chloride is a negatively charged ion. The neurons will become suppressed. Inhibitory neurons, they will function. Okay. Now similarly, there is an excitatory neurotransmitter known as glutamate. Remember, glutamate is an excitatory neurotransmitter, and they block glutamate receptor. The receptor of glutamate is known as NMDA receptor. Glutamate acts on NMDA receptor. So these drugs, remember, they are NMDA receptor blocker or glutamate receptor blocker. And glutamate, remember, is an excitatory neurotransmitter. Hence, excitatory impulses are blocked. So keeping this thing in mind, let's write those drugs. Okay, now on this GABA-A chloride channel, remember, they act on beta subunit. GABA-A chloride channel is just like a flower-like receptor on a cell membrane which has 5 subunit. So you have to refer to the videos of barbiturate and benzodiazepine to discuss the great detail of GABA-A chloride channel. So what are the drugs? So they act on beta subunit. So let's talk about what are the drugs. So you will write barbiturate, like sodium, like thiopentone, methoxyton, which we will be discussing. Barbiturates. The first drug you will write is barbiturates. Second you will write fluoranes, all the drugs which are ending with the word fluorine, methoxyfluorine, etomidate. Similarly, you will write lastly propofol. Okay, and the drugs which act on glutamate, they block glutamate receptor or NMDA blocker, are KCNX, K for ketamine, C for cyclopropane, N for N2O gas, and X for xenon gas. Okay, so all these drugs are NMDA blocker. Now let's see what is the other mechanism. Similar to GABA neurotransmitter which is present in the brain, in our spinal cord there is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. Remember, GABA is mainly present in brain. In our spinal cord we have another inhibitory neurotransmitter, glycine. So remember, they are also glycine receptor agonist. They also stimulate glycine receptor. Okay, now what are the drugs we have among glycine receptor agonists? Remember, all these drugs are even in glycine receptor except one, except etomidate. All these drugs, they also act on glycine receptor except etomidate. So the list will become barbiturate, फ्लोरेंस, इटोमिडेट, वी विल नॉट राइट इटोमिडेट, वी विल राइट प्रोपोफॉल. ओके, नाउ लास्टली रिमेंबर दे हैव वन मोर मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन. द फोर्थ लास्ट मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन इज, रिमेंबर सपोज दिस इज अ न्यूरॉन, सो दे हैव मेनली फोर मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन. इन दिस न्यूरॉन रिमेंबर दे ओपन व्हाट दे विल डू, दे विल ओपन पोटेशियम चैनल. ओके, सो इन दिस न्यूरॉन व्हाट दे विल बी डूइंग, यू विल राइट दे विल ओपन टू पोर पोटेशियम चैनल. नाउ यू नो दैट पोटेशियम इज मेनली प्रेजेंट इनसाइड द सेल. इफ पोटेशियम चैनल विल ओपन, रिमेंबर द पोटेशियम विल मूव आउट ऑफ द सेल. सोडियम इज प्रेजेंट आउटसाइड, पोटेशियम इज मेनली प्रेजेंट इनसाइड. ओके, सो इफ पॉजिटिव चार्ज विल मूव आउटसाइड, रिमेंबर द सेल विल बिकम हाइपर पोलराइज्ड. हाइपर पोलराइज मीन्स द सेल विल बिकम इनहिबिटेड. ओके, द सेल विल बिकम इनहिबिटेड, इट विल रिमूव दिस पोटेशियम आउट ऑफ द सेल. नाउ दे ओपन टू पोर पोटेशियम चैनल. दिस टू पोर पोटेशियम चैनल शॉर्ट फॉर्म इज नोन एज ट्रेक चैनल. टू पोर पोटेशियम चैनल. ओके, आर ई वर्ड हैज बीन टेकन फ्रॉम पोर, ट्रेक चैनल. नाउ द ड्रग्स विच एक्ट ऑन टू पोर पोटेशियम चैनल आर, रिमेंबर सेम दीज ड्रग, बट इंस्टेड ऑफ कीटामीन यू विल राइट फ्लूरेन, FCNX, साइक्लोप्रोपेन, N2O एंड जेनॉन. सो दीज आर द ओवरऑल फोर मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन. सो वी विल मेक अ समरी. सो दीज ड्रग्स दे एक्ट ऑन गाबा ए क्लोराइड चैनल एंड दे विल इंक्रीज द एक्शन ऑफ गाबा ए. दे ऑल्सो इंक्रीज द एक्शन ऑफ ग्लाइसिन. दे ऑल्सो ओपन पोटेशियम चैनल. And these all are inhibitory impulse. They also decrease glutamate action. How they decrease glutamate action? By blocking NMDA receptor. So they are NMDA receptor antagonist. So these are the four mechanism of action of general anesthetic agents that you must remember. Okay. So before starting with the drug, let's write certain important point with the history of general anesthesia. So before starting with the drugs, individual drug, let's talk about the history of general anesthesia. So if you want to talk about history of general anesthesia, you'll write a point that history of general anesthetic agent. So let's take this point very fast. So in history of general anesthesia, we will write the term anesthesia. It was coined by Oliver Holmes. The term anesthesia, it was coined by Oliver Holmes. The term balanced anesthesia is coined by Lundy and Waters. So this is an important question you must remember. Okay, it's very commonly asked. Father of anesthesia, Morton, very commonly asked. Morton is the father of anesthesia. Father of modern anesthesia, Long, it is also asked. Effect of either demonstrated by Morton. Either anesthesia used by first time was by Long. Okay, N2 effects was demonstrated by Horace Wells. First IV anesthetic agent was thiopentone and it was used by Lundy. First endotracheal intubation was by Megill. Chloroform as an anesthetic was used by Simpson. And local anesthetic cocaine was first used by Collar. Among them, try to remember the questions which I am marking. Okay. Okay, so try to remember these points, it's very important. So this is the history of general anesthesia. So let's talk about now the first drug among general anesthesia, that is inhalational agents. So let's talk about now inhalational agents among general anesthesia. Okay, now inhalational agents, if you remember, we have divided them into gases and volatile liquids. So let's talk about first gases. Okay, let's talk about first gases as a general anesthesia. Remember, all these gases which we have written, they are stored in cylinders. They are stored in cylinders. First point. And remember, from cylinder there is a tube through which this tube, this anesthesia gases are given to the patient. This tube is known as Boyle's circuit. This circuit is known as Boyle's circuit. Okay? Which is attached to the machine of general anesthetic agent. Okay? Now, 2 points you have to remember. That the first point is that every cylinder, it has a specific color coding system. Every cylinder has a specific color coding system. Every cylinder. So that in each cylinder, it is just for safety. So that in one cylinder, we should have one general anesthetic gases. And the second point is when this Boyle circuit is connected to a cylinder, remember for the safety, we have a pin index safety system. Pin index safety system, or known as PIS. Why? So that only one type of Boyle circuit will be converted into one type of cylinder. So these two things are done for the safety, so that there should not be mismatch between the gases and the gases which we want to give. So every gases is stored in a specific cylinder with a specific color coding system, and it has a specific pin index safety system. So let's talk about these gases and volatile liquid. So first let's talk about gases. And we will write pin index safety system or PIS. And we will write color coding of cylinders. Color coding of cylinders. Okay. So let's talk about gases now. So first gas you will write is air. Second you will write is oxygen. Third you will write, so they are non-anesthetic gases. But we have to give anesthetic gases, that is N2O, nitrous oxide, Antonox. Antonox is a mixture of N2O plus oxygen, 50-50%. Okay. Then you will write carbon dioxide. And last gas you will write is cyclopropane. Cyclopropane. Now if you talk about their pin index system, you will write air, it is 1 and 5. On one circuit there is 1, on cylinder there is 5, 1 and 5, okay. Then you will write 2 and 5 for oxygen, and nitrous oxide you will write 3 and 5, okay. These are pin index system. Then Antonox you will write only and only 7. Now carbon dioxide, remember, it could be more than 7.5% or it could be less than 7.5%. If it is more than 7.5%, we will write 1 and 6, 2 and 6. And with cyclopropane, we will write 3 and 6 number. Okay, these are pin index safety system. You just have to remember the numbers. Now, if you talk about the color coding of cylinder, remember this is a cylinder. Okay, suppose this is a cylinder. Now, remember this cylinder has a body. And this cylinder has a shoulder also. Okay, so let's see what is the color coding for air. Let's write the color coding for air. In case of some air, there is gray body with, you will write, black, white, shoulder. In cases of oxygen, it is black body with white shoulder. Black body with white shoulder. In cases of N2O, the whole cylinder is of blue in color. Whole cylinder, whether it is body and shoulder. In case of Antonox, it is blue body. The cylinder is of blue body with white shoulder. Okay. In cases of CO2, both cases, the cylinder is gray. In CO2, gray. And with cyclopropane, O word is coming, you will write orange. Okay, orange. So I'll repeat this point again for you. That in case of air, it is gray with black and white shoulder. In cases of oxygen, it is black. Okay. In cases of N2O, it is blue. In cases of N2O, again, it is blue with white shoulder. Okay. In cases of CO2, the whole cylinder is gray without any shoulder. And lastly, cyclopropane, it's orange. Now, if you talk about volatile liquids, these volatile liquids, remember, they are rather stored in vaporizing cylinders. Now, vaporizing cylinders, what is there? That vaporizing cylinder, we heat them. And after heating, these liquid, they evaporate. On evaporate, they will turn into gases. Now, each of this vaporizing stored cylinder has a particular color. Okay? And on that particular color, we will write the names of those drugs. The first drug you will write is halothane. Okay, sevoflurane, isoflurane, desflurane, and lastly, n-fluorane. We have not written methoxyfluorane because now methoxyfluorane is not used. We will write the name. Halothane, the color of cylinder is red. The color of cylinder is red in cases of halothane. In cases of sevoflurane, it is yellow. In isoflurane, you will write it is purple. And desflurane, you will write it is blue. In desflurane, it is blue. And lastly, n-fluorane, it is orange. So these colors you have to remember of these volatile liquids. Now, this is the general concepts. Now, let's talk about the properties. A very important, you will write pharmacokinetics or you will write properties of inhalational, general anesthetic agent. Properties of inhalational general anesthetic agent. Now, it will have different property, but you have to remember two terms. The first term is known as minimum alveolar concentration. The first term you have to remember is minimum alveolar concentration. The second term you have to remember is blood gas partition coefficient. Blood gas partition coefficient. These two terms you have to remember. After that, we will learn some other properties of general anesthetic also. But these two are very important. Now, minimum alveolar concentration is also known as MAC. And you have to remember this term MAC also. Okay, remember the word MAC. So let's start with these properties. Let's talk about first MAC. What do we mean by the word MAC? Okay. Now, before going further, you will write MAC. It tells us about the potency of general anesthetic agent. It tells us about the potency, that how much dose is required. And blood gas partition coefficient, it tells us about the solubility of general anesthetic agent in blood. Because of this reason, we will also find out about whether the general anesthetic agent is rapidly acting or slowly acting. Okay? So, potency means how much dose is required. Blood gas partition coefficient will tell us about solubility, and which will further determine, tell us about whether this agent is rapidly acting or slowly acting. So, this is the term you must remember first. So, let's talk about first MAC. What do we mean by the word MAC or minimum alveolar concentration? Now, the definition of minimum alveolar concentration you have to write is that minimum alveolar concentration is that concentration of general anesthetic agent in alveoli. So, this is the alveoli of the lungs. And you know, you have put an endotracheal tube. Through with this tube, you are giving a general anesthetic agent to a patient. Okay, so it is the concentration of the general anesthetic agent in alveoli that produces unresponsiveness in 50% of patients. That produces unresponsiveness in 50% of patients to a noxious or surgical incision. To noxious or surgical incision. So you have to remember, concentration of general anesthetic in alveoli that will produce unresponsiveness in 50% of the patient to noxious or general incision. Now what does it mean? It means that suppose this is the alveoli, and this alveoli, remember, the concentration of a general anesthetic agent in alveoli is, let's say that concentration is 100%. This whole general anesthetic is fully filled in alveoli. And suppose, and this 100% of concentration, this general anesthetic will come into the blood. And what we have seen, that when it is fully filled, all the alveoli are fully filled, 100% alveoli is fully filled with general anesthetic, it is known as 100% MAC. And in this 100% MAC, remember, only 50% of the patient will develop general anesthesia. Will develop general anesthesia. 50% of the patient will not respond when we will give a surgical incision. So can we say that if the concentration of an agent in alveoli is just 10%, let's say it's 10% MAC, only 10%, not 100%. And in 10% MAC means 50% of the patient will develop general anesthesia. They will not respond to surgical incision. That means this A1, it require full concentration. This B1 require only 10% of the concentration in alveoli to produce anesthesia in 50% of the people. So can you tell me which of the general anesthetic agent, A or B, will require lesser dose? Can we say that B will require lesser dose as compared to A? Can we say that B will require lesser dose as compared to A to produce anesthesia in 50% of the people? So can we say that 10% of MAC is of B and 100% of the MAC is of A? So can we say, if the MAC is less, can we say that the general anesthetic agent will require lesser dose to produce anesthesia? So you have to remember that MAC, if the MAC is high, it means the general anesthetic will require higher dose. The general anesthetic will require higher dose. And it is equal to, remember, higher dose means less potent. Less potent. If a general anesthetic agent will require higher dose means less potency. So overall, you have to remember that MAC is inversely related to potency of general anesthetic agent. Potency means dose required. Okay? Potency means how much less dose is required. So if an agent required lesser dose, it means the agent is more potent. So remember, higher MAC, the agent is less potent. And if there is lower MAC, the agent will require lesser dose. That means the agent will be more potent. More potent means lesser dose to produce anesthesia. So let's take an example to understand it further. Let's take an example that there is an agent known as methoxyfluorine. Methoxyfluorine. Okay. Now methoxyfluorine MAC value, MAC percentage value is, let's say, 1.6%. Okay. 1.6. So can we say that if this is alveoli, it will just require 1.6% of the volume of alveoli. It will require 1.6% of the volume of alveoli and it will anesthetize 50% of the people. So can we say that this lower the MAC, more potent is the general anesthetic. Suppose there is another general anesthetic, nitrous oxide. The value of nitrous oxide is 104%. Now 104% means that it may require 104%, that is more than the volume of alveoli, to produce anesthesia in 50% of the individual. You have to remember that overall methoxyfluorine is the most potent general anesthetic agent. Methoxyfluorine is the most potent general anesthetic agent overall, because the value of MAC of methoxyfluorine is lowest. And the value of MAC for nitrous oxide, remember, is highest. Highest means that it is the least potent general anesthetic agent. That means it requires more than 100% of alveoli volume, which is not possible, to more than 100% of the volume of alveoli to anesthetize 50% of people. So can we say that nitrous oxide, can we say that nitrous oxide, it requires more than 100%, more than 100% of alveoli volume, that means around 104%, to anesthetize 50% of people, of patient. So can we say it is practically not possible, because more than 100% space is not possible? So can we say that N2O can never anesthetize its 100% of people, of patient? So can we say that N2O can never be anesthetized, cannot anesthetize 100% of the people? That is why N2O is never a complete anesthetic gas. It is never a complete anesthetic gas, because it itself cannot produce complete anesthesia. Okay, it is the least potent agent. Okay, so remember this part. Now, what are the factors which affect MAC of an individual? Factors affecting MAC. So remember, minimum alveolar concentration, which represent potency, MAC can be increased. Increase in MAC or decrease in MAC. It can be affected by various body changes. Okay. If there is increase in MAC means that now we will require higher dose of a drug. Increase in MAC means that we will require higher dose of a general anesthetic agent. Decrease in MAC, we will require less dose of general anesthetic agent to produce an effect. So increase in MAC occurs in cases of increase in temperature of the body, that is hyperthermia. In case of hyperthermia, we require higher dose of general anesthetic agent. Okay, increase in MAC. Okay, similarly, you will write increase in thyroid. So second point, you will write increase in thyroid or hyperthyroidism. Increase in sodium or hypernatremia. You will write CNS stimulant drugs like coffee, analeptics, etc. Lastly, you will write metabolic alkalosis. Okay, so remember, in this case the drug, we have to give higher drug. Hey, in the cases in which we will require lesser dose of, or the MAC will be reduced, you will write that decrease in temperature or hypothermia, decrease in thyroid function or hypothyroidism, decrease in BP or hypotension. Remember, hypotension reduces MAC, but there is no role of hypertension in relation to MAC. MAC is not affected by high BP. But low BP may affect MAC. Okay. Then you will write decrease in oxygen, that is hypoxia, and hypercapnia, that means increase in CO2. Okay. Then you will write metabolic acidosis, pregnancy and old age. So pregnant people and old age, they require less dose of general anesthetic agent as compared to a normal person. Okay, so this is all about MAC. Now the second parameter we will discuss is known as blood gas partition coefficient. Now, let's see what do we mean by the word blood gas partition coefficient. Now, after alveoli, After alveoli, the general anesthetic agent, remember, it comes into the blood. It comes into the blood. Okay, general anesthetic agent will come into the blood. Now, when this general anesthetic will come into the blood, in blood, remember, this general anesthetic gases, they can remain in two form. Either they will remain in gas form or they will become soluble in plasma. They will become soluble, they will dissolve in plasma. Okay, now, so can we say that this general anesthetic will become in a gas form or it will be converted into soluble form? They will dissolve in plasma. Now you have to remember one point, that this gas form is insoluble. As this gas form is insoluble, remember, it can cross blood vessel and it can enter into brain. So it is insoluble, it can cross into brain or CNS and it can produce general anesthetic effect. It can produce anesthesia, it will cause CNS anesthesia. So which form of general anesthetic can cross cell membrane? That is gaseous form, and only gaseous form can cross into the brain and produce general anesthesia. It is not the soluble form. Remember, soluble form cannot cross cell membrane. Okay, cannot cross cell membrane. Soluble form will remain in the blood. It will remain in the blood. It will not enter into brain. It will not enter into the brain. Now, what do we mean by the word blood gas partition coefficient? Blood gas partition coefficient. Now, blood gas partition coefficient means that if the agent has high blood gas partition coefficient, it means the drug is more soluble. The drug is more soluble in blood. And if the drug is more soluble in blood, high blood gas partition coefficient means high solubility of a general anesthetic agent. High means more soluble. And if it is more soluble, can we say it will slowly enter into the brain? It will slowly or not enter into brain. Because of this reason, if an agent has high blood gas partition coefficient, the general anesthetic agent will have slow onset of effect and slow recovery from general anesthesia. Okay, so high blood gas partition coefficient means the drug will remain soluble in the brain, soluble in the blood, the drug will not enter into the brain, hence the drug will have slow onset of effect and slow recovery. Okay, so remember this part. So if you will say, so let's write an example of blood gas partition coefficient. Okay, blood gas partition coefficient. So if you talk about blood gas partition coefficient, let's talk about example that there is a gas known as xenon. The blood gas partition coefficient of xenon is 0.14. Similarly, you will write desflurane. It is 0.45. N2O nitrous oxide, 0.47. Okay. Now, let's go to the extreme side, that is methoxyflurane. Let's talk about ether. Let's talk about methoxyflurane, it is 11, either it is 12. That is very high. Remember, this is the lowest value and this is the highest value. Okay. Now, can we say that if the blood gas partition coefficient of an agent is very low, the agent will have fast onset and fast recovery? Okay. So the fastest acting general anesthetic agent we have is xenon. The second fastest we have is desflurane. The third fastest acting agent we have is nitrous oxide. The lowest, if the blood gas partition coefficient is very high, the drug will have slow onset and slow recovery. So you cannot use this drug as an induction of anesthesia. So overall, the slowest acting drug we have is ether. And the second slowest we have is methoxyflurane. and the second slowest we have is of methoxyfluorine. Hence, can we say that ether is a very slowly acting general anesthetic agent? Because of this reason, that scientist named Goodell, he defined four stages of ether anesthesia. Why he defined four stages of ether anesthesia? Because ether was producing very slow effect, you can easily demarcate all the four stages of ether, okay, because of its slow action. So overall, the fastest acting drug we have is xenon. Overall, the shortest acting, slowest acting drug we have is ether, okay. So remember this part. So I'll just show you certain summary of blood gas partition coefficient and blood gas partition coefficient of the drugs, and we will also write the summary of MAC values of certain drugs. This values you have to remember, okay, these values you have to remember. The MAC of N2O is overall highest MAC is of N2O, okay, that is why N2O is the least potent. Okay, least potent agent is this one. Now the lowest MAC you are seeing is of methoxyfluorine, and the most potent general anesthetic agent we have is methoxyfluorine. After methoxyfluorine, you can see that is halothane. The second most potent is halothane. Okay. Now, if you talk about blood gas partition coefficient, it tells us about the solubility of a drug and onset of action. Overall, the fastest acting was xenon. Xenon is very rarely used. As you can see, that desfluorane has the lowest blood gas partition coefficient. Desfluorane. Because of this reason, you will write desfluorane is the fastest after xenon. It is the fastest induction and fastest recovery. And you are seeing that methoxyfluorine has the highest. Can we say that methoxyfluorine has the slow onset and slow recovery? Methoxyfluorine has slow onset and slow recovery. So overall, most potent in this list is highest and least potent, slowest and fastest acting. Okay, so you have to remember this. So this is the list of blood gas partition coefficient and minimum alveolar concentration of the drugs. Okay, now let's talk about certain other relevant parameters, other relevant properties of general anesthesia. Okay, other relevant properties. So the first property you will write is oil water partition coefficient. Okay, second you will write fat blood partition coefficient, and lastly you will write brain blood partition coefficient. Now these parameters are not very important for you, so you can skip this part, but let's have a little bit idea what do we mean by oil water partition coefficient. Now oil water partition coefficient was earlier used. Nowadays this partition is not used. Okay, nowadays we don't use this partition. Now what do we mean by the word oil water partition coefficient? Let's understand this part. Now suppose you have given a drug general anesthetic, and this general anesthetic is present in blood, and you know that blood is a watery media. Okay, and so this general anesthetic is present in blood and it enters into brain CNS. And in brain CNS, you know, it acts on cell membrane. And cell membrane was made up of lipids. Earlier, it was believed by Mayer-Overton rule or unitary hypothesis that general anesthetic agent will act on lipid. Lipid is an oily substance. Okay. So if a drug has high oil and water coefficient, that means more of a drug is deposited in lipid cell membrane of the brain. Because of this reason, high oil water coefficient means more drug is in cell membrane of CNS. Can we say because of this reason, the drug will be more potent, more drug will be deposited in the brain, and this general anesthesia will require lesser dose to produce general anesthetic effect. But remember, now this coefficient is not used. The reason is, earlier we used to believe that they interact with the lipid cell membrane by Mayer-Overton rule. If you remember that hypothesis. But now we know that they don't interact with lipid membrane, they rather interact with the protein part in CNS. Hence, it was earlier used, oil-water partition coefficient was earlier used to find potency of general anesthetic agent. Okay, it was earlier used to find potency of general anesthetic agent. Now it is not used. Now to find potency of general anesthetic agent, we use a term known as MAC, that is minimum alveolar concentration. So it is now have become useless or redundant. Now fat blood partition coefficient, brain blood partition coefficient. Now we know that a general anesthetic is present in blood and it is present in gaseous form. Now can we say it can move into various organs? It can move into various organs and distribute into various organs. Now this various organs could be fat. So it is known as fat blood partition coefficient. And if it is brain, it is known as brain blood partition coefficient. So this coefficient will tell us about how much amount of the general anesthetic is distributed in various organs. So how much amount of general anesthetic is distributed in various organs, it will tell us about that parameter only. It will not tell us about the effect of general anesthetic. So it is not of a very important parameter for us. Okay, so remember. So let's talk about first individual drugs now. Let's talk about now individual drugs. And in individual drugs, let's start with the first part, that is gases. And the first gas we will start is nitrous oxide, also known as nitrous oxide. Now nitrous oxide is also known as, it is also known as laughing gas. Okay, it is also known as laughing gas. Now what is the mechanism of action of nitrous oxide? If you remember, just think and tell me. It is NMDA antagonist. It blocks the receptor of glutamate. Plus remember, it also increases the level of glycine. But a very important point, it also stimulates opioid receptors. It is also opioid receptor agonist. Now because of this reason, it, as an NMDA antagonist, remember it is an anesthetic agent. Okay, because of opioid receptor agonist, it stimulates opioid receptor. Remember, it is a very strong analgesic agent. Analgesic means pain relieving substance. So it has both anesthetic property and analgesic property. Analgesic means it will relieve pain. But remember, anesthetic property is very weak. Anesthetic property is very weak. Analgesic property is very high. Okay. So let's talk about now certain properties of N2O. Okay, let's talk about certain properties. Now, first point is, it has maximum value of MAC, minimum alveolar concentration. Its value of MAC was 104, if you remember. Okay, because of this reason, you will write N2O overall is the least potent. Overall, it is the least potent general anesthetic agent we have. It cannot produce complete anesthesia. It cannot produce complete anesthesia. It's a weak anesthetic agent. Okay. So alone, it cannot produce complete anesthesia because it will require more than 100% of alveolar concentration to anesthetize 50% of the individual, which is practically not possible. So because of this reason, what is the use? The use of this MAC is, it is given as an add-on drug. It is given as an add-on drug. Okay. Now the second point you have will write that its blood gas partition coefficient. Its blood gas partition coefficient is very low, 0.47. Because of this reason, can we say it is very least soluble? And because of this reason, it will have a very fast onset of action and fast recovery. It has fast onset of action and fast recovery. It means when it will come into the blood, when it will come into the blood from MAC, alveoli, this is alveoli. It will come into the blood. From blood, it will rapidly enter into brain. So it can easily cross, it is least soluble, it can easily cross cell membrane barrier. From alveoli, it will rapidly come into the blood. From blood, it will rapidly go into the brain. Okay, that is why it will have fast onset and fast offset of recovery. Now, because of this property, this very fast onset of effect, we will write that there are three properties of N2O we have to remember. Three properties of N2O. The first property of N2O you have to write is concentration. Concentration effect. Second property you will write is known as second gas effect. And the third property you will write is diffusion hypoxia. So these three points with N2O are very important for you. Okay. The first point you will write is concentration effect, second gas effect and diffusion hypoxia. Now keep this thing in mind that when we give N2O in lungs by endotracheal tube, it will rapidly come into the blood and from blood it will rapidly go into the brain because it is least soluble in these fluids. So concentration effect means that when we give N2O, N2O will show rapid diffusion. It will show rapid diffusion from alveoli to blood. It will show rapid diffusion from alveoli to blood. Because of this reason, there is negative pressure. There is negative pressure in alveoli. The alveoli will become rapidly empty. And because of this reason, it will withdraw more N2O gas from cylinder itself. It itself will withdraw more N2O gas from cylinder. Because it will cause rapid diffusion from alveoli to blood, there will be negative pressure in alveoli, more withdrawal of N2O will occur on its own. Now the point is, what we can do, instead of connecting, because of negative pressure is there, instead of, as there is negative pressure in alveoli, instead of withdrawing more N2O in the blood, we can mix this N2O with other gases. Mix N2O with other gases. Or that is why it is known as second gas effect, like oxygen, like halothane. Because of this negative pressure of alveoli in the blood, can we say it will withdraw more oxygen and halothane from cylinder? Okay, it will withdraw more oxygen and halothane from the cylinder. This property of N2O, that N2O creates a negative pressure in alveoli, because of this reason it can withdraw other gases from the cylinder. This is known as second gas effect. This is known as second gas effect. So because of this reason, what is the use of N2O? If you talk about the use of N2O, N2O is used as a carrier for other gases. Because of its second gas effect, it is used as a carrier for other gases. Example, oxygen. We give mixture of N2O with oxygen. N2O will cause withdrawal of more oxygen. We generally give 66% N2O and 33% oxygen. Okay, so remember this part. Now last point is diffusion hypoxia. Now think this point in an opposite way. Now diffusion hypoxia in a reverse fashion. Now diffusion hypoxia occurs when we stop N2O inhalation. That means after stoppage of N2O anesthesia or inhalation. Now what will happen if you will stop inhaling N2O? Can we say when we will stop inhaling N2O, this N2O will come from the brain into the blood back, and from the blood it will rapidly come into the alveoli because the pressure in alveoli is less. Can we say when we will stop N2O anesthesia, can we say that N2O will rapidly come back to alveoli? So when we stop anesthesia, N2O will rapidly diffuse back into alveoli and it will suddenly fill whole alveoli. This whole alveoli will be filled by N2O. So this whole alveoli will be filled by? Alveoli is filled by N2O, nitrous oxide. Because of this reason, there is no oxygen in alveoli. Can we say after stoppage of anesthesia, then there will be no oxygen in alveoli? It can lead to, due to diffusion of N2O back to the alveoli, it will cause diffusion of N2O, and less oxygen causes hypoxia. So this is known as diffusion hypoxia. So diffusion hypoxia is seen when we suddenly stop giving anesthetic agent. So this N2O will come back into the alveoli very rapidly. So how to treat this? How to treat this diffusion hypoxia caused by N2O? The treatment of diffusion hypoxia is give 100% oxygen for 5 minutes. 100% of oxygen for 5 minutes after you are withdrawing anesthesia. Diffusion hypoxia is treated by giving 100% of oxygen for 5 minutes. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see the uses of N2O. The first uses of N2O is it is used as a carrier for oxygen and other gases. So which property? Second gas effect. It is has a strong analgesic property. Remember, N2O is used in dental surgeries. Dental surgery, why? Because it has strong analgesic effect, pain relieving subs. Analgesic. So these are the two uses of N2O. Let's talk about now side effect of nitrous oxide. The first side effect of nitrous oxide is, as we know that nitrous oxide is a very light gas, it can diffuse into all cavities. So you will write, the side effect of N2O is it can diffuse into body cavities. It can diffuse into body cavities. Because of this reason, it is absolutely contraindicated, because it can cause pneumothorax. Pneumothorax means the space between the two lungs, two pleura of the lung. Pneumoperitoneum. It can also lead, it is contraindicated during laparoscopic surgeries. Because in laparoscopic surgeries, we create an artificial cavity in abdomen. Okay, so it can extend. Remember, it is also contraindicated during ocular surgery, eye surgery, middle ear surgery. Okay, because they are also cavity, and it can lead to air embolism. So remember, all these are the contraindications of nitrous oxide. Now the second side effect of nitrous oxide is, remember, nitrous oxide inactivates vitamin B12. It inactivates vitamin B12. You know that vitamin B12, it contains cobalt. So it inactivate or react with cobalt. It reacts with cobalt. Because of this reason, vitamin B2 will not able to produce this effect. Now remember, vitamin B12 is required to convert homocysteine into methionine. As we know that vitamin B12 is not functioning, because of this reason, we will write that N2O is absolutely contraindicated in homocystinuria, when the level of homocysteine is already very high. Okay. Now, it can also lead to B12 deficiency. It can also lead to B12 deficiency. And B12 deficiency presents to you with peripheral neuropathy. So it can cause peripheral neuropathy. It can lead to subacute combined degeneration of spinal cord. Spinal cord neurons will get damaged. And lastly, it can cause megaloblastic anemia. So these are the side effects of B12 deficiency. Megaloblastic anemia. So remember, because of B12 deficiency, we never give N2O in long term. Never give chronic N2O therapy. N2O is never given in long term. Because long term, application of nitrous oxide will lead to B12 deficiency. Hence, it is given for very short procedures. Okay. So, this is about nitrous oxide. The next gas we will write is Antonox. Now, what is Antonox? Antonox is 50% nitrous oxide plus 50% oxygen combination. So, this is the Antonox. 50% nitrous oxide, 50% oxygen. So, it's a mixture of 50% N2 and 50% oxygen. Now, the point is, when you will mix these nitrous oxide and oxygen in 50-50%, you will write these gases, they lose individual property. These individual properties of gases will be lost, and these two gases will behave as a single gas. They will behave as a single gas. Okay. And because of this reason, it can be stored in one cylinder. It can be stored in one cylinder. And I've told you the color of that cylinder was pure blue. Blue with white shoulder. Okay. Now, this property that when we mix two individual gases and they lose individual property and behave as a single gas, this property is known as Poynting effect. This property is known as Poynting effect. So, what is Poynting effect? When we mix two individual gases and they lose their individual property and behave as a single gas, this is known as Poynting effect. Now, what is the advantage of giving this Antonox? Can we say that this Antonox has N2O? And N2O will provide a very good pain relief. It's a strong analgesic. And it is also having oxygen, so there is no hypoxia, which was seen by N2O. So it will provide very good pain relief with no hypoxia. Because of this reason, this gas is used in ambulance. So in ambulance services, we give these gases without any risk of hypoxia to the patient. It will provide pain relief without risk of hypoxia. In ambulance car, you generally use Antonox gas, and it can be given as a single cylinder. Okay. Now the third gas you will write is xenon. Xenon. Okay. Now if you remember about xenon, xenon has overall highest Mach. Xenon has high Mach. High Mach, its Mach is around 71, plus low or overall lowest blood gas partition coefficient. The blood gas partition coefficient, if you remember, was 0.14. Okay. So because of this reason, we will write it is the fastest acting drug. First induction of anesthesia and fast recovery. That means fast onset and fast recovery. Okay. And because of this reason, it is a very less potent agent. It requires very high dose. Okay. So these two properties are similar to N2O. These two properties are similar to nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide also has high Mach and low blood gas partition coefficient. Okay. So remember this part. Now, let's talk about first, what is the action, mechanism of action of xenon. Xenon was NMDA antagonist. Xenon was NMDA antagonist and it opens two pore potassium channel or TREC channel. Okay, which hyperpolarizes neuron. What is the use? It is used just like N2O. Its use is in place of N2O, nitrous oxide. It is also used as a carrier for oxygen. It is also used as a carrier for oxygen. Now, we give a mixture of 70% xenon with 30% oxygen. 30% oxygen. Now, what is the advantage of giving xenon? The advantage of giving xenon that xenon is an inert gas. It's an inert gas. It is non-inflammable. and it is non-irritant. Okay? Because of this reason, it has no effect on heart, blood pressure, etc. Because of this reason, it is a very safe agent to use, very safe gas to use. But unfortunately, the main drawback of xenon is that this xenon is a very rare gas. And this rare gas we cannot obtain from atmosphere. Because of this reason, it is very less available and it is very highly costly, high cost, very high cost. Because of its high cost, it is now very rarely used, very rarely used because of high cost. Second point is, it is denser than oxygen. It is more heavier than oxygen. Okay? Because of this reason, when we give xenon, the patient finds difficulty in breathing because the patient has to give very high effort. High force have to apply to during breathing. Okay? So it is denser, so it is difficulty in breathing. Now, because of to overcome this density, we have developed the last gas, last inert gas, that is helium. That is helium. Now, helium is also an inert gas. But remember, it is lighter than oxygen. Lighter than oxygen. Okay? It is lighter than oxygen, but more viscous than oxygen. Okay, so it is lighter than oxygen. So because of this reason, a patient can breathe this helium gas very easily. So how it is given? It is given as a mixture of helium with oxygen. It is also given as mixture of helium and oxygen. We give 79% helium and 21% oxygen. This combination is known as heliox. This combination is known as heliox. Now, what is the uses of helium gas? Now, first you will write, as it is lighter than air, so it is used in the cases of airway obstruction. So this heliox is used in cases of airway obstruction because it is lighter than oxygen. Second point is, this helium has high thermal conductivity. Okay, that it can easily burn. Because of this reason, that means it will not burn even in high temperature. Hence, it is used in laser surgeries. It has high thermal conductivity, so it will burn an area very easily. The heat content, it can carry very high much amount of heat without going into explosion or anything. So it is used during laser surgeries also and airway obstruction also. So this is all about gases. Now let's talk about volatile liquids. Now the first volatile liquid you will write, if you remember the mnemonic, I have told you, catch my side. C for the drug is chloroform. Okay. Now, chloroform was a very earlier used anesthetic, but remember now it is not used. Now it is not used because this chloroform is highly hepatotoxic. It is highly hepatotoxic and it is highly cardiotoxic. Because of this reason, highly hepatotoxicity and cardiotoxicity, we don't use chloroform. Chloroform forms free radical. It forms free radicals which damages it is a highly hepatotoxic. It can lead to cancers also, liver cancers also. Okay, so not used. Now the second point you have right is either. E for either. Okay, now either, it has a very great advantage that this either, you will write, it is a very safe anesthetic agent. Even in unexperienced people, it can be used by even unexperienced people. If a doctor is inexperienced, it can be used. It is very safe. It can be used by unexperienced doctors. It has a very good analgesic effect. That means pain relieving property. Plus, it has a very good muscle relaxant property. It has a very good muscle relaxant property. Okay, and the other advantages are that it does not react with soda lime. What is soda lime? I will be telling you shortly. It is not cardiotoxic. It is not hepatotoxic, just like chloroform. It is not cardiotoxic, not hepatotoxic. Because of this reason, either can be used very safely. But the drawback of either are that this either has a very slow onset of action and slow recovery. Why? Because it has highest blood gas partition coefficient, if you remember, that was 12. Okay. Second point is that this either has irritant property. Why it has irritant property? Because it has a pungent smell. It has a pungent smell. Now, because of its pungent smell, when the person will inhale either, it can lead to muscle spasm. It can provoke asthma. It can provoke nausea and vomiting, which can be treated by giving atropine-like drug. Okay, and it can also increase laryngeal secretion, which is undesirable in cases of anesthesia, because it can go into lungs and lungs will have aspiration pneumonia. So it has a pungent smell, which can provoke asthma, nausea, vomiting, and laryngeal secretion. But you have to remember one point. Ether itself is a bronchodilator. It dilates bronchus. But because of its irritant nature, it causes bronchoconstriction. Second point with ether is that ether is highly inflammable. And it can cause explosion. Because of this reason, ether, it can never be used with electric current known as electric cautery. Ether cannot be given with electric cautery because it is highly explosive or inflammable. So in those cases, we will know. So nowadays, remember, we don't use ether. Because of its very slow action, its use is obsolete. Not used nowadays. Okay. So now we use other agents. Now the third agent we will write is trialine. Trialine. Now trialine, if you will write, it is overall most potent pain reliever or analgesic. The best pain relieving property is of trialine. The best pain reliever we have is trialine. Okay. But the point with trialine is that this trialine, remember, it is never used in closed circuit. Never used in closed circuit. It is always used in open circuit. Now, what do we mean by the word closed circuit and open circuit? Let's understand. Okay. Now suppose there is a patient who is lying on a table. Okay. Now in this patient, as you know, that you are giving general anesthetic gases. You are giving general anesthesia gases along with oxygen. Okay. So it will go to the patient. And after that, there is a tube through which there is exhalation. The gases are removed. Now you know the gases which are removed by the patient are carbon dioxide and same amount of general anesthetic gases. So the gases which is inhaled by the patient is general anesthesia and oxygen. The gases which are exhaled by the patient are carbon dioxide and GA. Now there is a point. There are two types of circuit. Either we can remove, we will cause loss of these gases in atmosphere. These gases are lost in atmosphere. This is known as open circuit. Or what we can do, we can reuse these gases again. We can reuse these gases. Why we can reuse these gases? Because there is general anesthesia. Now when you are reusing these gases, this is known as closed circuit. When you are reusing these gases, this is known as closed circuit. Now in this closed circuit, we have an agent known as soda lime. Why we give soda lime? Because this soda lime will remove carbon dioxide. This soda lime will remove carbon dioxide in closed circuit. So in closed circuit, we have to remove CO2 by adding soda lime, and general anesthetic gases can be used again. So GA will be used again. So it will become very economical to use this closed circuit. Okay. Now the point is, why we don't use trialene in closed circuit? Trialene is never used in closed circuit. The reason is, trialene never given closed circuit. The reason is, you will write that this trialene, it reacts with soda lime. This trialene, a general anesthetic gas, it will react with soda lime. And when it reacts with soda lime, it forms two chemical. One, it forms phosgene gas. And second molecule it forms is dichloroacetylene. It forms phosgene gas and dichloroacetylene. Now you have to remember that this phosgene gas causes lungs damage. It causes acute respiratory distress syndrome. It will cause sudden lung damage, ARDS. And this dichloroacetylene, it goes into the body, it is highly neurotoxic. Remember, it damages 5th and 7th cranial nerve. It will damage 5th and 7th cranial nerve. That is why we never give trialene with soda lime. So you have to remember that trialene should not be given with soda lime. It reacts. Now the fourth drug you have to remember is cyclopropane. Now remember, cyclopropane is highly inflammable and highly explosive. My question is, if it is highly inflammable and highly explosive, would you like to give them in open circuit? Remember, it is never given in open circuit. In open circuit, the drugs are removed into the atmosphere. Why? It can lead to explosion. So cyclopropane is always given in closed circuit. Always in closed circuit. So I have already told you that trialene is always given in closed circuit. It is always given in open circuit, never in closed circuit. While cyclopropane is never given in open, it is always given in closed, because in open circuit it will lead to explosion. Trialene in closed circuit will react with soda lime. Okay, so remember, these are the two agents with different uses, different mode of action. Trialene always given in open, cyclopropane always given in closed circuit. Okay, now this cyclopropane has one advantage, as one property, that it causes sympathetic stimulation. It stimulates our sympathetic nerves. As it stimulates sympathetic nerves, remember, it increases blood pressure of the body. As it increases blood pressure of the body, remember, it is used in cases of shock or circulatory collapse. When the patient blood pressure is very low, we give cyclopropane. But what is the disadvantage? Remember, when cyclopropane is suddenly stopped, due to sudden stoppage of cyclopropane, there is sudden decrease in sympathetic activity. So there will be sudden decrease in BP. There is sudden fall in BP, and the patient will go into shock. So sudden stoppage of cyclopropane also leads to shock. This shock is known as cyclopropane shock. So what is cyclopropane shock? Cyclopropane shock is sudden stoppage of cyclopropane will lead to sudden fall in BP, and the patient will go into shock due to sudden decrease in sympathetic activity. Okay, so this is all about cyclopropane. Let's talk about now the next anesthetic agent, that is halothane. Okay, let's talk about now halothane. Okay, a very important agent. Remember everything about halothane. Okay, so let's talk about halothane. Halothane, you will write, is that it is a very potent anesthetic agent. It's a highly potent anesthetic agent. But remember, it also has muscle relaxant property. It causes muscle relaxation. So can we say it will cause bronchodilation? It will cause uterine relaxation. So that we will write shortly. It will cause vasodilation, which can lead to hypotension. So it has a muscle relaxant property as well. But remember, halothane has no analgesic property. It cannot relieve pain. No pain relief. So that is why when you give halothane, you have to give analgesic agent from outside. Okay? No analgesic property. Now the third point with halothane, you will write that it is having high blood gas partition coefficient. It has high blood gas partition coefficient. Because of this reason, it has slow onset and slow recovery from anesthesia. That is why halothane is given for maintenance of general anesthesia. It cannot be given for induction of general anesthesia. It is given for maintenance of general anesthesia because of high blood gas partition coefficient. Okay. Now let's see, how do we store this storage of halothane? It is also asked from you. So suppose this is a bottle in which we store halothane. So suppose this is the bottle. Okay. So this is a glass bottle. And there are rubber seals. There is a rubber seal. Okay. And in this we have the solution of halothane. In this bottle we store halothane. Now let's see what is the special storage condition which is required. For the first point, you will write that these bottles should be of amber color. The color of the bottle is amber color bottle. So you will write the bottles are amber color bottle. First point. Why the bottle should be amber colored? Because halothane is photosensitive. Halothane degrades in presence of light. Halothane is photosensitive, so you have to protect from the light. Second thing you have to remember, in this halothane, what we will do, we will add thiamol. We add thiamol as preservative. Why we add thiamol as preservative? Because it will inhibit vaporization of halothane. Because we know it's a volatile liquid, it will inhibit vaporization. Now, second point you will write that in this halothane, we add a red vaporizer. Red color vaporizer. Because if this halothane gets leaked from rubber tube, it can leak from rubber tube, we can easily identify. So it will detect leakage from rubber tube. This red color vaporizer will detect leakage from rubber tubes. So these three things you have to remember. The first is amber color bottle, which will prevent the entry of light. Thiamol as preservative, which will inhibit evaporation of halothane. And red color vaporizer, if it gets leaked, so we will able to identify. So these three points you have to remember. So keeping this thing in mind, let's make a summary of properties of halothane. Properties of halothane in one summary. And we will write a mnemonic that is Halothane IP. We'll write a mnemonic Halothane IP. First H stands for that halothane has high blood gas partition coefficient. Because of this reason, it's a very slow acting drug. It is given for maintenance of general anesthesia. Maintenance general anesthetic. Second point you will write with halothane is A for it causes asthma safe. It is asthma safe. Why? Because it is bronchodilator. It is bronchodilator and it is the drug of choice in asthma. Halothane is the drug of choice in asthmatic people as a general anesthetic agent. L for it is liver toxic or hepatotoxic. Okay. O for it causes vasodilatation, which can produce sudden orthostatic hypotension. Why there is sudden orthostatic hypotension? Due to vasodilatation in the body. Okay. Fifth, you will write it has thymol as preservative. Thymol preservative will inhibit vaporization or evaporation of halothane. Sixth, you will write it causes a dangerous side effect known as hyperthermia. It causes a dangerous side effect hyperthermia, which is also known as malignant hyperthermia. Halothane causes a dangerous side effect known as malignant hyperthermia. Remember, malignant hyperthermia is caused by four drugs known as Shell. That is succinylcholine, halothane, atropine, and lignocaine. And most common is caused by halothane only. And the treatment of malignant hyperthermia is rapid cooling, 100% oxygen, give acidosis. The drug of choice is dantrolene sodium, which is a muscle relaxant. For the complete description or details of malignant hyperthermia, please refer to the videos of local anesthetic or refer to the videos of skeletal muscle relaxant, where we have discussed skeletal muscle relaxant dantrolene. Okay. Now, seventh, you will write it causes arrhythmias. Why halothane causes arrhythmias in heart? Because it sensitizes heart to catecholamines. Catecholamines are epinephrine, norepinephrine, etc., which stimulate heart and it can lead to arrhythmia. That is why it is contraindicated in a tumor in which levels of catecholamines are very high. It can provoke arrhythmia. It is contraindicated in pheochromocytoma surgeries. Halothane is contraindicated in pheochromocytoma. Okay. Now you will move further. Eighth, it is non-explosive and non-analgesic. Non-explosive and non-analgesic. No pain relieving property. Ninth, you will write it end uterine contraction. It end uterine contraction or it has tocolytic property. It relaxes uterus. Because of this reason, it is very much preferred in cases of cesarean section. It is very much preferred in manual removal of placenta when you have to need a relaxed uterus. Or when you want to do internal version of uterus, internal rotation or version of fetus, there you need relaxed uterus and the mother should be having, should be anesthetized. Okay. Next point you will write, it causes increase in intracranial tension, ICT, maximum among all anesthetic agent. That is why it is contraindicated in head injury patients. And lastly, it causes post-anesthetic shivering. Why it causes post-anesthetic shivering? Because of vasodilatation, there is sudden hypothermia, loss of heat. And this hypothermia leads to post-anesthetic shivering. Now to treat this post-anesthetic shivering, the drug of choice is one opioid pethidine. We give an opioid, pethidine, which is also known as meperdine. The drug of choice for post-anesthetic shivering is pethidine. Okay, pethidine regulates our temperature centers in our brain and reduces the shivering. So this is the complete mnemonic for the properties of halothane. So the mnemonic we have written H A L O halothane IP. Okay, so this is all about halothane. Now let's talk about now fluorines. That is halogenated anesthetic. Halogenated anesthetic, which is also known as fluorines. Okay, so if you remember that fluorines, the mnemonic was micide. That was methoxyfluorine, sevoflurane, isoflurane, desflurane, and lastly enflurane. Okay, and if you compare their blood gas partition coefficient, that means whether they are slow acting or fast acting, and minimum alveolar concentration, so you will write 12, 0.65, 1.4, 0.45, and 1.9. So can we say the maximum and lowest? So it is the slowest acting and it is the fastest acting among them. If you talk about the MAC values, we will write 0.2, 1.4, 1.05, 5.7, and lastly 1.68 or 1.7. So as you can see from this value, the lowest value is 0.2 and the highest is 5.7. So it is most potent. Lowest MAC is most potent, less, and it is least potent. So least potent is desflurane. Okay, and it is also the fastest acting. Methoxy is most potent but slowest acting. Okay. Now let's talk about each drug. The first drug is methoxyfluorine. Okay, methoxyfluorine. Now methoxyfluorine was the first fluorine anesthetic to be made. It was the first fluorine anesthetic, but now it is not used. Why it is not used? We will remember why. Because methoxyfluorine, first point you will write, it has highest fluoride content. It has highest fluoride content, and this high fluoride content, remember, is high fluoride. It is highly nephrotoxic. And this high fluoride, remember, is also highly hepatotoxic. Because of this reason, nowadays we have stopped using methoxyfluorine, because excessive amount of fluoride will lead to kidney damage and liver damage. Second point with methoxyfluorine is it says inflammable. It is inflammable, hence it is now not used nowadays. Okay. So let's talk about now the second drug, a very important drug for you, that is sevoflurane. So it's a very important drug for you, remember. So let's talk about sevoflurane. So the first point is sevoflurane has fast onset and fast recovery. Because of this reason, you will write it is used as an inducing agent. Now let's talk about certain properties of sevoflurane. First properties of sevoflurane is it is sweet smell. It is sweet smelling. Because of this reason, it is used in infants and children. It is also given in daycare surgery. Daycare surgery means we call the patient and send the patient very same day because it has fast onset and fast recovery. Okay. Second point we will write that it is stable in cardiac and neuro patients. It doesn't affect cardiac parameters and brain. Because of this reason, it is the drug of choice in cardiac surgeries and neurosurgeries. That is sevoflurane. Again, let's talk about its side effect now. The main side effect of sevoflurane, you will write, it causes soda-lime reaction. If you remember soda-lime reaction, in which circuit? In closed circuit. It reacts with soda-lime in closed circuit. Now, when it reacts with soda-lime, it forms known as a molecule known as compound A. It forms compound A plus carbon monoxide gas. Carbon monoxide gas and compound A. Now, this compound A, remember, is nephrotoxic. This compound A is nephrotoxic. Okay? Now, the second side effect you will write, that it causes seizures. It causes seizures. So this is about sevoflurane, sweet smelling, hence preferred in children and daycare surgery, stable in cardiac and neuro patient, drug of choice in cardiac and neurosurgery. It causes soda-lime reaction and seizure. In soda-lime reaction, it forms compound A and carbon monoxide. Compound A is nephrotoxic. Let's talk about now other drugs. Second drug you will write is isoflurane and desflurane. Now, isoflurane and desflurane, you will write that they are given as for maintenance. Maintenance general anesthesia. Okay. Their common side effect is they cause laryngospasm. Why they cause laryngospasm? Because they are not sweet smelling, they are rather pungent. They are pungent smelling. Okay, sevo was sweet. Now let's talk about their properties. If you will write that desflurane also causes soda-lime reaction. It also causes soda-lime reaction. So what are the drugs which causes soda-lime reaction? List, you will write STD. These three drugs, they cause soda-lime reaction. That is sevoflurane, compound A, trialine, which was forming phosgene gas and dichloroacetylene, and desflurane. So these drugs, they cause soda lime reaction, STD. Now if you talk about isoflurane has a vasodilating property. It's a vasodilator. Because of this reason, it decreases blood pressure. Isoflurane decreases blood pressure. So if you talk about use, it is the drug of choice in hypertensive individual. If you are doing surgery in hypertensive individual, we give isoflurane. The reason is it produces controlled hypotension. We can give to produce controlled hypotension. Second point you will write that this isoflurane, it produces a side effect. It causes coronary steel syndrome. It causes redistribution of coronary blood flow from ischemic area to non-ischemic area. Hence, it will aggravate MI and angina. That is why it is absolutely contraindicated in MI and angina people. So what about coronary steel syndrome in detail? Please refer to the videos of angina. We have discussed coronary steel syndrome with a drug. I will give you the list of the drugs which causes coronary steel syndrome. The list is HIND. The first drug you will write is hydralazine, isoflurane, nitroprusside, and dipyridamole. These drugs, they cause coronary steel syndrome. So please refer to the videos of angina and see about dipyridamole, the complete details of coronary steel syndrome. Okay. And the last drug you have to write is enflurane. Okay, now enflurane is also given for maintenance. Okay, now it has slow onset and slow recovery. What is the side effect of enflurane? Remember, enflurane causes epilepsy or seizures. and it is also hepatotoxic. Okay, so it is absolutely contraindicated in epilepsy patient or seizure patient. That you have to remember, E for enflurane and E for epilepsy. Okay, so if you talk about the comparison of if you will compare all these general anesthetic agent, inhalational general anesthetic agent, so if you talk about their comparison, let's see how they will affect our body parameter. First is cardiovascular system. In cardiovascular system, you will write heart rate, cardiac output, and you will write blood pressure. If you talk about heart rate, maximum decrease in heart rate or maximum bradycardia is by halothane. Maximum decrease in heart rate is by halothane. And most cardiac neutral, which will not affect with the heart rate, is desflurane and isoflurane. And sevoflurane, all these three drugs. They are cardiac neutral. If you talk about cardiac output is increased by halothane. It is increased by halothane. Sorry, it is decreased by halothane. Okay, that is why it can lead to hypotension. And most neutral drug in cardiac output is sevoflurane. It doesn't interfere. If you talk about BP, maximum decrease in BP or hypotension is again by halothane. Okay, and most neutral out here is isoflurane. Sorry, that is sevoflurane again. The sevoflurane you are seeing is more neutral. Halothane is more of a decreasing side. If you talk about intracranial tension increased by, so intracranial tension, if you talk about intracranial tension is increased by, we will write intracranial tension is maximum increased by halothane. So that is why halothane is contraindicated in head injury. Okay, and it is neutral, not increased, not decreased by isoflurane. Okay, so most preferred drug will become in head injury will be isoflurane. Okay, then if you talk about uterine contraction or relaxation movement, so uterine relaxation is maximum by halothane. That is why it has tocolytic action. Okay, similarly you will write neutral, all other are neutral, all others are neutral, all fluorines others are neutral. Last is bronchodilator. So remember, bronchodilation in asthma people, asthmatic, it is maximum by halothane. And in non-asthmatic people, it is by sevoflurane. Sevoflurane produces bronchodilation in non-asthmatic, while in asthmatic people, halothane produces bronchodilation. That is why halothane is the drug of choice in status asthmaticus, when the patient is having emergency, their whole respiratory tract has gone into contraction. Okay, so this is all about inhalational general anesthetic agents. Okay, so now let's start with intravenous inducing agents. Okay, so we have completed with inhalational general anesthetic. Let's start with general anesthetics, which are given intravenously. And remember, these drugs are mainly given as an inducing agent for induction of anesthesia. Some of them will be given for maintenance as well. So the drugs which we have already discussed, the mnemonic was temperature, temp, Kelvin. Okay, so T stands for thiopentone. Okay, E for etomidate, M for methohexitone, P for propofol, and K for ketamine. Okay, so these are the drugs. So let's start with the first one, that is thiopentone. Let's make a heading, thiopentone. Okay. Now, what is thiopentone? We will write sodium. Thiopentone, it is also known as sodium pentothal. Another name of thiopentone is sodium pentothal. Now, what is the mechanism of action? Remember, it's a barbiturate. It's a barbiturate. And the main mechanism of action of barbiturate is that they are GABA A chloride channel agonist. They also have action on glycine, but their main action is they are GABA A chloride channel agonist. Okay. Now, let's talk about certain properties of thiopentone. Now, if you think about thiopentone, it's a yellow colored powder. It's a yellow color powder. And this yellow color powder is an acidic powder. Okay. Now, it is reconstituted, remember, in a solution of sodium bicarbonate. It is made in a solution of sodium bicarbonate. So remember, sodium bicarbonate is an alkaline solution. Hence, the pH of this solution of thiopentone sodium or sodium pentothal is alkaline pH. So sodium pentothal has an alkaline pH of 10.5. Okay, it has a 10.5. Now the reason why it has an alkaline pH, why we are making in alkaline, because this alkaline pH inhibits bacterial growth. It inhibits bacterial growth, that is why. Okay, so it inhibits bacterial growth. Now the second point with sodium pentothal or thiopentone is it has high volume of distribution. Okay, and it gets redistributed into fat. It gets redistributed into fats. It shows a phenomenon of redistribution into fats. And that is why its mechanism of action is terminated. It shows redistribution into fats. And it has a plasma protein binding with albumin of around 85%. Okay. Now, keeping this thing in mind, let's see the uses of thiopentone. Now, if you talk about thiopentone, it is given as an intravenous inducing agent, inducing general anesthetic, and for maintenance we give gases like halothane, sevoflurane, etc. Second, it is also given in status epilepticus to control seizures. Thiopentone is also given in status epilepticus. Now, it has a very great advantage in status epilepticus. It has a very great advantage that thiopentone, it has neuroprotective effect. It has neuroprotective or cerebroprotective effect. The reason is it reduces cerebral metabolic rate. It reduces the oxygen requirement of the neurons. Hence, it has a neural protective effect. Okay. Now, lastly, it also have anti-thyroid property. So these are the three points you must remember with thiopentone. That is why it is the drug of choice for producing anesthesia in surgery. SX means surgery in hyperthyroid people. In hyperthyroid individual, the anesthetic of choice is thiopentone. Okay. So try to remember these three terms with thiopentone. Now, let's talk about the contraindications and side effect of thiopentone. First, about contraindication. Remember, thiopentone should never be mixed. It should never be mixed in acidic ringer lactate. So, it is always given in sodium bicarbonate. It should never be given in acidic ringer lactate, because in acidic solution, it precipitates. It forms precipitate. Second, it should be never given as an arterial injection. It should never be given as arterial injection, because if it's given as an arterial injection, remember, it damages endothelial cell. Due to damage of endothelial cell, there is formation of thrombus, and it will lead to thrombophlebitis, thrombus formation and inflammation of artery and vein. And thrombophlebitis causes this injection to be highly painful. This injection will be highly painful and there will be reduction in the blood supply to the distal organ. Now, how to treat this thrombophlebitis in artery due to thiopentol? Remember, do not remove the needle. Do not remove the needle of thiopentol. Keep that needle in the same place. And what you will be doing, you will flush with saline. Flush with saline. Why we want to flush with saline? So that it will dilute. To dilute sodium thiopentol. Then you have to dissolve clot. To dissolve clot, you will give heparin and fibrinolytic known as urokinase. Okay, and you have to reduce pain. To reduce pain, we give with the same needle. With the same needle, we will be giving lignocaine. So this is how you have to manage if we have accidentally given an arterial injection of thiopentol. Okay, now the third point is it should never be given in acute intermittent porphyria. Remember, barbiturates are absolutely contraindicated in porphyria. So never in acidic situation, never in arterial injection, and never in acute intermittent porphyria. Now let's talk about the side effects of thiopentol. We know that all barbiturate, if you talk about the side effect, all barbiturate, they are highly sedative drug. So it produces sedation and it causes amnesia. It produces amnesia. That is why it is sometimes given in a test known as narcoanalysis. Thiopentol is also used in a test known as narcoanalysis to take out the truth from a criminal. So it is also known as truth serum. Because if a person will tell a lie, because of memory loss and sedation, the person will not able to tell a lie. Okay. It also produces hypotension. It also produces hypokalemia. Thiopentone. And lastly, thiopentone produces double apnea. Apnea means stoppage of breathing. Now, why it produces double apnea? When you give thiopentone, when a patient inhales thiopentone, the thiopentone has a pungent, garlic-like smell. Because of this reason, the person will stop breathing. And in high dose, remember, thiopentone directly goes to the brain and depress respiratory centers. It will cause respiratory depression. So, these are the two causes of apnea or stoppage of breathing due to thiopentol, due to pungent smell and due to direct respiratory depression. Okay, now let's talk about the second drug, that is methohexitone. Okay, now methohexitone is also a barbiturate. Now the point with methohexitone is that methohexitone provokes seizures. It causes seizures. Thiopentone reduces seizure, methohexitone provokes seizure. Why it provokes seizure? Because it reduces seizure threshold. It reduces seizure threshold. Because of this reason, methohexitone is the drug of choice in those therapy where we want to provoke seizure in a patient. It is the drug of choice in during electroconvulsive therapy. Convulsion means seizures. So when we give electric shock to an individual, to provoke seizure, we give methohexitone and we sedate a person with methohexitone. Now what is the side effect? The side effect of methohexitone is the injection of methohexitone is painful. It causes painful injection. Okay. Now remember, there are three drugs which causes painful injection. You will write the order. Most painful is P, then M, then T. Most painful injection, you will write, is of propofol, which we will be discussing. Second is methohexitone. And lastly, you will write thiopentone. So these three drugs, they have painful injection. And most painful is methohexitone. So painful injection is of these three drugs. Now let's talk about the third drug, that is etomidate. Now etomidate, remember, it is most hemodynamically stable agent. That means it does not interfere with blood pressure and heart rate. Because of this reason, it is a drug of choice as an inducing agent in cases of, so the mnemonic is M, H and S, that is M, H and S, most hemodynamically stable. So it is a drug of choice in these three conditions. Remember, it is a drug of choice in myocardial disease. Drug of choice in myocardial disease patient or heart disease patient, like chronic heart failure patient, myocardial infarction patient and aneurysm patient. In heart disease patient, it is a drug of choice as an inducing agent. For maintenance, we give sevoflurane. Inducing agent, etomidate. Maintenance, we give sevoflurane. Okay. Then second point you will write, it is also given in hypotensive patients. Okay. Like if the patient has hemorrhage, if the patient has some splenic rupture or any internal organ rupture which is causing bleeding. And lastly, it is also given in senile or old age patient, because in them hypotension can develop very easily. So it is given in these three conditions. Okay, etomidate. Now let's talk about the side effect of etomidate. So we have already, you will write, etomidate also has painful injection, but less. Most painful was propofol. It causes nausea and vomiting. And nausea and vomiting is maximum among all intravenous agents. Maximum nausea and vomiting is by etomidate. It also causes vitamin C deficiency. And lastly, it causes corticosteroid deficiency. Why it causes corticosteroid deficiency? Because it inhibits synthesis of corticosteroid. Why it inhibits synthesis of corticosteroid? Because it inhibits one enzyme, 11 beta hydroxylase, which is required for synthesis of corticosteroid. That is why it can cause adrenal failure. So etomidate causes adrenal failure or adrenal insufficiency. Okay. So remember these three, four side effects of etomidate. Now the second last drug we have is propofol. Okay. Now propofol, if you talk about mechanism of action, propofol was GABA A agonist, chloride channel agonist, while it is also an NMDA blocker. Okay, NMDA blocker. Now let's talk about the chemical properties of propofol. Okay. Now propofol, remember, it is given as a milky white emulsion. It is reconstituted in milky white emulsion of 1%. Now this milky white emulsion contains propofol, and this propofol is mixed with, you will write, soya bean oil. Okay. It is mixed with eggs and it is mixed with glycerol. So it is given with this mixture. Okay. Soya bean oil, eggs and glycerol. Because of this reason, now you will write that this propofol, it is contraindicated in egg allergy patient. The patient who have allergic to eggs, it is contraindicated. Second point you will write, that propofol should always be freshly made or freshly prepared. It should always be freshly prepared. And it should be used within 6 hours. It should be used within 6 hours, because otherwise this propofol will lead to, you will write, bacterial growth. Otherwise it will lead to bacterial growth. That is why propofol, whenever you want to use it, you have to prepare it freshly, because this soya bean oil, egg and glycerol will lead to bacterial growth. Okay. And the pH of propofol is also alkaline. It's 11. Okay, 11. Now let's talk about the uses of propofol. Uses of propofol. Now, propofol, remember, it is the most commonly used general anesthetic agent. Among all drugs, it is the most commonly used. And remember, it is used for both induction as an inducing agent as well as for maintenance. Okay? It is given for both induction and maintenance. So, keeping this thing in mind, let's see the uses of propofol. So, the uses of propofol, you can write a mnemonic day, time. So, the first use of propofol, remember, it is a drug of choice for during day care surgeries. The drug of choice for day care surgeries is propofol. It's a very important question. Propofol is a drug of choice as an anesthetic agent for day care surgery, those surgeries in which we discharge the patient on same day. Okay. Propofol is a drug of choice for total intravenous anesthesia. That it can be given for both induction and maintenance alone only. Total intravenous anesthesia where you don't want to give gases. So, drug of choice is again propofol. Total intravenous anesthesia. Third, it is also given for ICU sedation. If you want to sedate a person in ICU. Okay. Fourth, you will write, it is also given in cases of malignant hyperthermia. Because in malignant hyperthermia, it is the safest GA, general anesthetic. And lastly, remember, it also end nausea and vomiting. That means it has anti-emetic effect. Remember, it also has anti-pruritus effect. It also reduces pruritus. Okay. So try to remember these points with propofol. Now let's talk about the side effects of propofol. Side effects of propofol. Okay. So, let's talk about side effect of propofol. The first point is the injection is highly painful. And among all, it is the most painful. Now, why this injection of propofol is most painful? Because it is oily. It contains soybean oil, etc. That is why we have made fospropofol. Fospropofol, remember, is water soluble. Because of this reason, It is less painful. Second side effect, remember, it has plasma protein binding. And among all general anesthetic agent, it has maximum plasma protein binding. Okay. The third side effect you will write, although plasma protein binding is not the side effect, it causes pancreatitis. Okay. Pancreatitis. It also causes opisthotonus. It also causes opisthotonus. Now, opisthotonus means coriform movement. The person will have abnormal posture or movements. Okay, dancing like movement or coriform movement. Okay, coriform movement. The next point you will write, it also leads to pleasurable effect. Pleasurable effect means that the person will become addictive to it. It will show addiction. And the last point you will write, that it causes a syndrome known as Pris syndrome. Pris syndrome stands for propofol related infusion syndrome. Propofol related infusion syndrome. What happens in propofol related infusion syndrome? Sometimes it's a very rare condition. Sometimes there is sudden cardiac failure. The heart will fail. There is degeneration of muscles, rhabdomyolysis. And there is also liver failure. And the person may die. Now, why it occurs? It is an unpredictable reaction. We don't know why it occurs. It's a very rare idiosyncratic reaction. It occurs due to inhibition of mitochondrial रेस्पिरेटरी चेन और इलेक्ट्रॉन ट्रांसपोर्ट चेन इन माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया. समटाइम्स प्रोपोफॉल इनहिबिट एटीपी जनरेशन इन माइटोकॉन्ड्रियल रेस्पिरेटरी चेन विच कैन लीड टू ऑर्गन फेलियर. सो इट्स अ वेरी रेयर साइड इफेक्ट. सो ट्राई टू रिमेंबर द साइड इफेक्ट्स ऑफ ऑफ प्रोपोफॉल. तो पेनफुल प्लाज्मा प्रोटीन बाइंडिंग मैक्सिमम पेंक्रेटाइटिस और पिस्थोटोनस प्लेजरेबल इफेक्ट एंड प्रेस सिंड्रोम. नाउ द लास्ट इंट्रावीनस एजेंट वी हैव टू रिमेंबर इज कीटामीन. ओके कीटामीन. नाउ कीटामीन रिमेंबर केमिकली कीटामीन इज ऑल्सो नोन एज, इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन, इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज फिनाइल साइक्लिडीन डेरिवेटिव. इट इज नोन एज फिनाइल साइक्लिडीन. वट इज द मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन ऑफ कीटामीन? कीटामीन इज एन NMDA ब्लॉकर. इट ब्लॉक्स द रिसेप्टर ऑफ ग्लूटामेट. सो इट ग्लूटामेट ब्लॉकर. NMDA इज द रिसेप्टर ऑफ ग्लूटामेट. ओके नाउ रिमेंबर दिस दैट कीटामीन इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज एंजल डस्ट. एंजल डस्ट. इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज डेट रेप ड्रग. डेट रेप ड्रग. सो द कंप्लीट लिस्ट ऑफ द ड्रग्स विच आर नोन एज डेट रेप ड्रग यू हैव टू सी द लिस्ट ऑफ सी बारबिट्यूरेट चैप्टर सेडेटिव एंड हिप्नोटिक. एंड वाई एंड लास्टली यू विल राइट इट इज ऑल्सो हाईली एडिक्टिव. हाईली एडिक्टिव सब्सटेंस. सो इट्स ड्रग ऑफ अब्यूज. ओके कीटामीन. नाउ लेट्स सी वट इज द इफेक्ट कीटामीन विल प्रोड्यूस. इफेक्ट कीटामीन विल प्रोड्यूस. रिमेंबर कीटामीन इट हैज टू इफेक्ट. इट प्रोड्यूसेस डिसोसिएटिव एनेस्थीजिया. इट प्रोड्यूसेस एन इफेक्ट नोन एज डिसोसिएटिव एनेस्थीजिया कीटामीन. एंड इट इज ऑल्सो अ स्ट्रॉन्ग एनल्जेसिक एजेंट. एनल्जेसिक मीन्स स्ट्रॉन्ग पेन रिलीवर. ओके नाउ डिसोसिएटिव एनेस्थीजिया मीन्स दैट देर इज लॉस ऑफ कॉन्शियसनेस बट देर विल बी नो लॉस ऑफ प्रोटेक्टिव ऑटोनॉमिक रिफ्लेक्सेस. तो रिफ्लेक्स एक्शन विल बी प्रिजर्व्ड. ओके द रिफ्लेक्स एक्शन विल बी प्रिजर्व्ड. लेट्स से वन रिफ्लेक्स एग्जाम्पल गैग रिफ्लेक्स. That means the content of the stomach will not come into esophagus. From esophagus, it will not go into the lungs. So, can we say that ketamine is the drug of choice to perform surgery in full stomach people? So, if the person is having full stomach, the drug of choice to perform surgery is ketamine because it will preserve the gag reflex or all other reflex. Okay, so that is why. This ketamine is sometimes known as conscious. The anesthesia produced by ketamine is known as conscious sedation. Sedation. Conscious means reflexes are preserved. Sedation means the person is unarousable. The person is sleeping. Okay? Person is sleeping. Now, the next point with ketamine, you have to remember that ketamine also has sympathetic stimulating activity. It causes sympathetic stimulation. It increases sympathetic activity in the body. So, keeping this thing in mind, let's see the uses of ketamine and the effects of ketamine. The first point you will write that ketamine is a bronchodilator. Now, remember, sympathetic activity causes bronchodilation. Because of this reason, it is a drug of choice as an inducing agent. Inducing agent in asthmatics. For maintenance, you can give halothane. For maintenance, remember, you give halothane. Or you can also give sevoflurane. Okay, because they all are bronchodilators. Second, it also, as it is causing sympathetic stimulation, remember, it causes cardiac stimulation. Sympathetic nervous system stimulate heart and it also causes vasoconstriction. So, can we say more blood will come to the heart? Because of this reason, it is the drug of choice as an inducing agent. Okay, it is a drug of choice as an inducing agent in cases of shock people, the patient who are having less cardiac output or shock, when the blood pressure is less. Okay, it is also the drug of choice in DIC. DIC is disseminated intravascular coagulation. The patient goes into shock. And it is also the drug of choice in congenital heart disease. Congenital heart disease means the patient is having right to left shunt. Right to left shunt, because in right to left shunt, we need to produce vasoconstriction in the body. If a patient is having right to left shunt, suppose this is the heart, this is the right heart, this is the left heart. The blood is going from right to heart. Remember, we produce vasoconstriction so that more blood should go into the heart and so that it can easily go from right part of the heart to left part of the heart. Okay, so remember. Now the drawback of ketamine is that ketamine increases oxygen demand of various organs of the body like brain or neurons. Because of this reason, remember, ketamine causes seizures. It does not have neuroprotective effect. But if you talk about thiopentone reduces seizures because thiopentone decreases oxygen demand of the brain. So let's talk about the side effect of ketamine. The side effect, you will write a mnemonic vice. So V for, you will write, ketamine causes vivid dreams or it causes hallucination. Okay, hallucination. Because of this reason, remember, ketamine is contraindicated in psychotic patient like schizophrenia, because in schizophrenic patient there is already hallucination. Second point, you will write, it increase intracranial tension and intraocular tension. Because it increases intracranial tension, it is contraindicated in head injury. In head injury, already intracranial tension is increased, and in glaucoma, because already intraocular tension is high in glaucoma. It also causes cardiac stimulation. As it causes cardiac stimulation, can we say the demand, oxygen demand of the heart will increase? Because of this reason, it is contraindicated in MI people, MI and angina individual, because it will precipitate the attack of MI and angina. Remember, here the drug of choice was etomidate. Etomidate was hemodynamically stable drug. And lastly, we know it is epileptogenic. Epileptogenic means that it causes seizures. We have already discussed. Hence, it is contraindicated in people who are suffering from epilepsy. Okay? Ketamine is contraindicated in people who are suffering from epilepsy. Okay? Now, let's write the comparison of intravenous agents. So let's write the comparison of intravenous inducing agents. And we will compare four drugs. The first is thiopentone. Second, you will write is etomidate. Third, you will write propofol. And lastly, ketamine. So let's compare these drugs with various parameters. The first is half-life. You will write that thiopentone among these four are longest acting. Among these four. And the shortest acting drug is ketamine. Okay. You will write plasma protein binding. PBB is plasma protein binding. You will write propofol, it has maximum. And ketamine, it has minimum. Okay. Which drug will cause nausea and vomiting maximum? Okay, thiopentone has no effect. Etomidate increases nausea and vomiting. Propofol decreases nausea and vomiting. Ketamine causes maximum nausea and vomiting. Ketamine causes maximum nausea and vomiting. Okay, now let's write about other parameters like blood pressure, cardiac output or stimulation of heart. Cardiac output. You'll write intracranial tension, intraocular tension and respiratory rate. Okay, so you will write that blood pressure will be reduced, cardiac output will be reduced, intracranial tension, intraocular tension, and respiratory rate will be reduced by thiopentone. No effect will be seen with etomidate. Okay, propofol causes maximum decrease. Propofol causes maximum decrease in BP, cardiac output, and respiratory rate. And ketamine rather increase them. So which agent will increase them? That will ketamine. Ketamine will rather increase them. Okay, I hope you have understood now. And lastly, this is all about the properties of IV inducing agent. Okay, IV inducing agent. That is thiopentone, etomidate, propofol, and ketamine. Okay, ketamine. Now let's talk about the last class of drug in general anesthetic agent, that is adjunctive drugs. That is adjunctive drugs or add-on drug. Adjunctive or add-on drugs in general anesthetic agent. Okay. So we will write certain drugs. The first drug, a very important drug for you, is dexmedetomidine. Dexmedetomidine. Now what is this? Dexmedetomidine, remember, it is an alpha-2A agonist. It's an alpha-2A agonist in CNS or brain. Because of this reason, alpha-2A are sympathetic receptors. They are inhibitory receptors in our brain. It produces three effects. It causes sedation, it causes pain relief, analgesia, and it decreases sympathetic activity. So it's an inhibitory receptor, it reduces sympathetic nervous system activity. SNS means sympathetic activity. Now let's talk about the use. If you talk about use, dexmedetomidine is given as pre means before, peri means during. Pre and perioperative sedation and pain relief. Okay, it is given as pre or perioperative sedation and pain relief. Okay, now what is the side effect? As it reduces the sympathetic activity in the body, remember, dexmedetomidine causes hypotension, the blood pressure will fall down. And it causes bradycardia. So in hypotension and bradycardia, it should never be given. Okay. Now this is the side effect. Now what is the disadvantage? Why it is not used as a main anesthetic agent? Because remember, it will not produce. Dexmedetomidine cannot produce loss of consciousness. So it is not an anesthetic agent. It is just an add-on drug to produce sedation and analgesia. Okay. It will not produce amnesia. Amnesia means loss of memory. And it will not produce muscle relaxation. So just think about the term balance anesthesia. In balance anesthesia, we require these things also. So it cannot be produced by dexmedetomidine. Now the second class of drug as an adjunctive drug in general anesthesia are analgesics. Analgesics means pain relief. Now, among analgesic, the first class of drug we have is opioids. And the second class of drug we have is NSAIDs. NSAIDs is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Okay? And remember, opioids are the drug of choice. For peri, peri means during, and post, that means afterward, operative pain relief. So, opioids are the drug of choice for peri and post-operative pain relief. Okay, so you can give various opioids which can be given IV, like morphine. You can also give pethidine. Remember, pethidine is also known as meperdine. So apart from pain relief, pethidine is also, you will write, is the drug of choice for post anesthetic shivering. Why shivering occurs? Due to hypothermia during operation, the body temperature reduces. Pethidine is also the drug of choice for post-anesthetic shivering. You use fentanyl group of drug. You use fentanyl group of drug. Okay. Now, remember, fentanyl is sometimes given with a drug known as droperidol. Droperidol, remember, is an antipsychotic drug. This combination is known as Neurolept. Neurolept means antipsychotic. Analgesia. Analgesia means pain relief. Okay? Pain relief. Now, if in this fentanyl and droperidol, you will also add nitrous oxide. These three drug combination is known as Neurolept anesthesia. So in Neurolept analgesia, we have two things. In analgesia, we have fentanyl and droperidol. If it is anesthesia, you will also add nitrous oxide. Okay. So remember this part. Okay. Now, then there is, we have a drug remifentanil. Remifentanil. Now, remifentanil, remember, it is the shortest acting opioid. Because of this reason, it is given during daycare surgery for pain relief. Daycare surgery for pain relief. Now, what is the side effects of opioid in anesthesia? Remember, opioids, they increase nausea and vomiting. Opioids, they cause nausea and vomiting. Okay. Opioids, they cause pruritus. Opioids, remember, they cause respiratory depression and they cause constipation. So that part of opioid, you have to see the videos of opioid, why they cause it. Okay. Now, because of the fear of respiratory depression, which can be dangerous, we nowadays use, we can also use NSAIDs. Okay. So we can also use the second drug as NSAID as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug for post-operative pain relief. So you can give paracetamol and ketorolac. Because these two NSAIDs, they can be given as an intravenous injection. Okay. So NSAIDs can also be given, but remember, for analgesia after operation, pain relief after operation, the drug of choice is opioids, not NSAIDs. Now the third class of drug you will write is benzodiazepine as an adjunctive drug. Now which benzodiazepine we use? Remember, we use benzodiazepines like midazolam, diazepam, lorazepam. Now these three benzodiazepine have been approved and they are the drug of choice. They are the drug of choice as a pre-anesthetic medication. Why they are given before anesthesia? They are the drug of choice as a pre-anesthetic medication as an anti-anxiety drug. They reduce anxiety to produce sedation before, to produce sedation and to produce amnesia. So benzodiazepines are the drug of choice as a pre-anesthetic medication to reduce anxiety, to produce sedation and to produce amnesia. And among them, remember, midazolam is the drug of choice. Midazolam is the drug of choice. Why midazolam is drug of choice? Because it has most rapid onset of action. And it can be given IV also. Okay? Okay? You can also use diazepam, lorazepam. There is a new drug right now which is not approved. That is remimazolam. Remimazolam right now is not approved, but it is also being, very soon it will get approved for pre-anesthetic medication. So these four benzodiazepines are used as pre-anesthetic medication. Okay. Now the fourth drug you will write is prokinetics. Now among prokinetic, we use two types of drugs. One is metoclopromide and second is domperidone. Okay. Now both these drugs, remember, are D2 receptor blocker, D2 antagonist. Now prokinetic word means that these drugs, remember, they will increase motility. That is why known as prokinetic of GIT. They increase the motility of stomach and they increase the motility of intestine. They increase the motility. Because of the motility of stomach is increased, can we say the content which is present in the stomach will go downward? Hence, it will reduce reflux into esophagus. Because reflux from the esophagus will increase the chance of aspirational pneumonia. Hence, they are reduced, given to reduce aspiration. As they will increase the motility of intestine, they are given for rapid bowel evacuation to make the intestine empty. For rapid bowel evacuation, we give them metoclopramide and domperidone. Okay. Now, last drug we have among general anesthetic is antiemetics. Antiemetics are given to decrease nausea and vomiting. And why they are given? To reduce nausea and vomiting, because all general anesthetic drug, they themselves can cause nausea and vomiting, and the drug of choice is 5-HT3 antagonist like ondansetron, granisetron, etc. So for their complete video, you have to see GIT section. But there is a new class of drug which have been recently approved, that is NK1 antagonist. NK1 is neurokinin 1 receptor antagonist, that is aprepitant, nectupitant, rolapitant. Okay. But these are the drug of choice, that is 5-HT3 antagonist. And the last class of drug we have is antimuscarinics. Antimuscarinics are also known as anticholinergic drugs. Okay. Now, the drugs among anticholinergic we have is atropine, scopolamine. Scopolamine is also known as hyoscine. And the last drug we have is glycopyrrolate. Okay. Now, why anticholinergic drugs are given? Because anticholinergic drugs, they reduce bronchial and laryngeal secretion. As they decrease bronchial and laryngeal secretion, they call dry bronchus, they decrease the chances of aspiration of these secretion into the lungs. Okay, which could be dangerous. To reduce bronchial and laryngeal secretion, we give this drug: atropine, hyoscine, and glycopyrrolate. Remember, this glycopyrrolate is a quaternary ammonium compound. Quaternary ammonium compound, remember, are water soluble. Okay, that means they have NH4+, that means charge ion. These two drugs are tertiary ammonium compound. Tertiary mean NH3, so they are lipid soluble. As glycopyrrolate is water soluble, it does not cross blood-brain barrier. It does not cross blood-brain barrier. Hence, it does not interfere with the respiration and other parameters which are vital during anesthesia. So, the most preferred drug is glycopyrrolate. Most preferred. Because it will not enter into the brain. It is water soluble. It has quaternary ammonium structure, which is a charged molecule. Atropine and hyoscine can enter into the brain. They enter into brain. They can interfere with respiration and other parameters. And this is the most preferred drug. Okay. So this is all about general anesthesia. So thank you very much.